Joining us now is Dr. Murphy. He's a professor of infectious diseases at Northwestern University Feinberg School of Medicine. Good morning. Thanks for being with us.
Good morning.
So it's, you know, some schools are just opening, some are closing. This seems to keep going back and forth. But then we hear winter sports are probably going to be happening. I'm wondering, how do you entertain sports, basketball, face-to-face when kids aren't even in school?
It's really not very smart. This whole school opening thing was way too soon. Look what's happening. You open the schools, you close the schools. It's just back and forth. Some schools get away with it, but on the whole, look what's happening. It's a disaster. Now, the colleges get away with it, the ones with the big sports programs. And you know why? They test the players every day. Every single day they get tested. Do these high school kids get tested? They don't even get tested at all. You can't do it that way. Maybe the testing will expand enough that they can start doing it. But this fall has been an experiment. It's failed. And look at the numbers around us in Illinois, and the states around us are even worse. But something has got to be done.
Well, yeah, I was going to ask you that. We're talking to a father coming up at 8 o'clock who's moving his family to Indiana so his son can play basketball. Now, we just, you know, read the Indiana number. It didn't seem much different from what's going on here. I know it's not as densely populated there as it is in Chicago, but what are your thoughts about that move?
Well, you know, the rural states are actually doing worse than New York and Illinois and the other states that have some control over this thing. Moving to Indiana for basketball, you have to put your priorities first. You know, if that priority is he's going to play basketball, even though he's got a higher chance of getting infected, bringing it home, infecting us, infecting the rest of the family, okay. I mean, that's their priority. That's their freedom. They have the freedom to infect other people. And that's just the way it is in this country. That's their prerogative. That's their prerogative.
I think there are some parents who say that schools have been open in Indiana, though, and the numbers are not much different. So what, you know, if we've been kind of locked down, most people not in school here, but they're going there and the numbers are the same. So how do you make sense of that?
Well, yeah, but the numbers are this. You have to be careful of the averages because in some places they get away with it. You know, you don't have the super spreader events for whatever reason. Some schools, there doesn't seem to be much impact. But in some schools, it's so bad they're closing. Like, look at the opening comments. You know, schools are opening, schools are closing. You know, it's all over the place. As a whole, it's failing. Yes, there are areas that get away with it.
I was kind of surprised looking at the map that Florida was one of the few states where it was not rising. What's going on there?
Well, there's a couple things going on there, two things really. One is the Floridian Public Health Department and the governor are the biggest cheaters in terms of numbers. One of their head epidemiologists, as you know, a couple months ago, actually quit because of that, started her own blog with the real numbers in it to try to get some sanity down there. The way they count, they weren't counting out-of-state residents. Half the people down there are from out of state. You know, there's a whole bunch of things they were playing with the numbers. Nobody believes them. The other thing is they did so badly at the beginning. They had this kind of big peak, and then some of the counties and the bigger cities, especially down in the southeast part of the state where there's a lot of infections, put some mitigation measures in and things went down. So they had kind of an earlier peak, so that might affect the numbers. And the other thing is they cheat.
All right, let's get to some viewer questions. If someone is diagnosed with COVID-19, are they still being told to go home and seek treatment only if symptoms worsen, or is there medication given at diagnosis now?
We aren't there yet. This is a great question because this is exactly what we need. What we need in this country, in this world, is that as soon as you're diagnosed with COVID, you go on some kind of treatment, just like we do with the flu. You get Tamiflu. As soon as you're diagnosed, the same thing is needed here. We don't have it. There are some drugs in development. Where are they? Why is the FDA not accelerating these like they're accelerating them with the vaccines? I don't know. So, you go home for 14 days. If you get sicker, you come back. That's what they tell you.
If someone had COVID and now has the antibodies, can they still be a carrier if they encounter someone who has COVID?
No, it doesn't work that way. So you get COVID and you get antibodies. Now, it turns out, it depends how bad your COVID was. If it wasn't so bad, you may not have made enough antibodies, like that guy in Nevada who got infected, was a relatively young man, as I remember, and then got COVID again, a different virus. So if you do develop the antibodies, you're not going to get it again for several months or years.
All right. Can we leave with one bit of good news? Anything in there you can tell us?
The good news? Let's see. The governor's going to make a statement today, and we have to go along with it. It's probably not going to be very much fun. No, the good news is the vaccine trials are continuing, and we are on target to get a vaccine, possibly one approved as early as the end of November, the Pfizer one. And this is what we have to look forward to, because that is going to give us herd immunity.
Gotcha.
And
herd
immunity is going to basically get rid of the whole problem.
Real quick, you mentioned that yesterday. How long for distribution? Is that a 2-month thing, a 6-month thing?
It's a 1-year thing at least.
Okay.
We've got 330 million people.
Yeah.
And some of those vaccines have to be kept at like minus 80 degrees. You know, it's like the distribution is going to be challenging. It is doable. But this it's just so massive.
All right, Dr. Murphy, thanks again. If you have a question for the doctor, go to our Morning News Facebook page, post it there. We'll talk to him again tomorrow. Thanks again.